Welcome to the Workplace Bullying Podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Gary Namy, social psychologist and the co-founder and director of the Workplace Bullying Institute. For nearly 25 years at WBI, we've devised solutions for everyone, from bullied individuals and unions to employers and lawmakers. This podcast showcases the reality of workplace bullying and abusive conduct and related phenomena from the dark side of the world of work and society. Thank you for tuning in. Well, my guest today is Ståle Einarsen, the director of the Bergen Bullying Research Group at University of Bergen, Norway. And he tells me he's been doing this work for 32 years. I'll ask him more about that as part of our introduction. He is cited in Google Scholars 43,571 times. In my own WBI research library, I probably have 35 of Ståle's articles in educating the professionals who come to attend our training. He is the go-to academician on the topic, and also I count him as a friend. So I thank you for joining me today, Ståle, and you have much to tell our audience, so I just want to get started. But thanks again.
Okay. It's a pleasure to be here.
Now, when we met first in 2002, I recall you telling me you had this interesting approach to doctoral dissertations with your graduate students, that you prefer, am I remembering correctly, you prefer publications and studies?
Yes, well, our PhDs are built up that way. So they write, I wrote five articles, and nowadays they write three to four, and then they write up a general summary. So that means that the work is published when they are finished. So that's the way we do it. Mm-hmm.
So much better than the obtuse, long, single doctoral dissertation that gets shelved and is never seen by anybody. And often, and people treat it like their magnum opus, and there's so much more work to be done. Now, tell us how you began academically. You have two degrees, as I understand. You have two focuses, foci.
I started psychology. So I studied for 6 years, clinical psychology, and I have a cited in clinical psychology. And then I went on to the doctorate in the general doctorate in, I took that in work and organization psychology in 1996. So I finished in 1990, 1991, and we did the thesis then on workplace bullying. So we started already there. And then we published some articles on that and a couple of Norwegian books. And then my PhD in work and organization came in out in 96.
Did you ever practice as a clinician?
Well, yes and no. Not as a clinical psychologist, but I've been working more like you in practice, work and organizational practice all along, but while doing research. So in that sense, and in those kind of instances, sometimes you get into more clinical work with victims or with managers, but not in a traditional sense. No,
I always thought that the perfect match with my Ruth being the clinician, and I being the sort of the management fellow and the teacher, but more focused on the business side. And I thought it was the perfect combination. And it's proven to be in that regard. But Ruth taught me so much about the clinical aspect. When you deal with targets of bullying, the victims, you get overwhelmed with the clinical part. I wanted to ask you about some of the early studies where you and your students were searching for a predictor trait for targethood. I always thought that was interesting because, one, I had a natural wonderment about it, natural curiosity, dealing with so many targets all the time. But summarize what you have found. It's not as simple a search as it sounds.
No, it isn't. Well, you will find target traits. You will find that. And what really astonished us is when you go into the more clinical aspects of it, or the targets that have been hit for this for years and so on. And then there came out a profile which turned out to be the same all across the world. So we found it in Norway, we found it in Denmark, we found it in Italy, we found it in an article, an American article, where they had no idea of bullying research. So what they did was that they looked at people who had taken their employers to court, and then they looked at those who had taken them to court due to harassment without having no knowledge. And what astonished me was that the profiles that we found were just the same. That said, we went a bit further than that. And then we looked at different profiles. So were all the victims the same? And then the question was, no, they were not. Victims are actually quite different. And then for one of the groups, they don't differ from the rest of us at all. And then we have one group which seems to be a reaction, which is more depression and paranoia. And then I had some Italian colleagues who looked at the items of paranoia, and then they said, well, let's first decide of these items. This was the MMPI 2, which is a 200-300 items, a clinical instrument. And then they first went in to say, well, let's look at the paranoia items as such, just look at them and divide them into those who you would have to say yes if you're bullied and those who you didn't have to say, you know. So this kind of pure paranoia and then kind of reaction to bullying. And then they scored this group again, and then they saw that, well, they have to score high on this because they're in the predicament that they are. So this seems to be a reaction, depression, paranoia.
And right. Then you have a smaller group.
Then you have a smaller group, 25%, which seems to have psychological problems up hand and on many levels. So, and that's also what we see in later research, that there are a subgroup, but the picture is the targets are as different as the rest of us. So I would say if no targets had a certain personality profile, then if they didn't have, then they would have been different because the rest of us have. Later on, we've seen more interesting thing in the more normal psychological, normal personality. And of course, there is a tendency of higher neuroticism. So reaction.
For our listeners, that's from the NEO scale, the five-factor personality scale. And neuroticism, not Freudian, but a hypersensitive emotionality, emotional reactivity. Okay, go ahead.
That's correct. And so there you will find an elevated scores on that for a target group in general. But what we have seen lately in a study we did in 2018 was very interesting, because there we looked at the combination of these traits and of work environment problems, let's say role stressors, role ambiguity, which seems to be the strongest predictor. And then you combine that with personality, and then we saw something interesting. And that is, if there are no stressors in the work environment, then these people do not have a higher risk of being involved in bullying scenarios. But when there are problems in the work environment, then they have a higher level. So you could say their reactivity comes along with other stressors in the work environment. But the work environment is always there as a stressor and a risk factor.
Right.
Personality only in given circumstances.
But in psychologically safe environments, even people who are high in neuroticism would be relatively safe then, because it wouldn't be triggered.
Good, great. But in work environment, where there are problems in work organization, in the division of work and in the role clarity, that is always a risk factor, independent of whether you score high, medium or low on this. The last thing we kind of take the whole range until lately, we just published it in last year. And there we followed a group of people over many 8 weeks. So we measure them We measured them 8 times over 6 months. Okay, so each third week, we measured them again. And then we looked at whether things escalated or de-escalated. And then we saw that perhaps personality was perhaps important in the sense that it was related to the lack of de-escalation.
Let me say that again. Lack of de-escalation. The failure to actually turn it off and to reverse.
Yes. So it may be that it isn't a risk factor in itself from the beginning on, but in combination with a bad organization, there is a risk. Well, bad organization is always a risk. But it could be that the risk is not necessarily only in the initial phases. It could be that what you need more help for is to kind of to de-escalate it. And if you think that you are a kind of highly sensitive, highly reactive person, and then of course to then kind of turn it off, isn't that easy?
The rumination, it explains it. It matches all the anecdotal data, that's for sure. Yeah. It's terrible that it can't. I was just watching a documentary on the Holocaust again, one of my favorite topics. And you know, bullying has been described as a mini Holocaust by some folks because of the the systemic nature and just so many other factors to it. But long story short, it's the Shoah Foundation is recorded survivors of the Holocaust, and there are very few left. So they've got this new interactive technique where people can visit and actually post questions to the people because they've recorded every possible answer. But I'm always struck by how Holocaust victims survived and thrived and got beyond. Mm-hmm. And part of the time I wanted to tell bully targets, my God, these people got through, this generation got through the most heinous things imaginable. And they see positivity in the world. Please, can't you, please? And it's it's quite a challenge. Yeah. Targets are where we started, Ruth and I, by listening. She got her PTSD from that her own experience, and then that kept re-traumatizing her till her psychiatrist told me, get her the heck out of the situation, to quit listening. Yeah. Yeah. So it's interesting. I had a quadruple bypass right after we met, the year after we met. It's the 20th anniversary. But I don't know what it was from. I think it was more physiological, but the trauma. But I sure have listened to a lot of targets in the thing, in the interim.
But I'd like to say one thing more about that. Because
yes,
following up about what you're saying now, because we had some findings which we had troubles of understanding in the beginning. Well, actually, we didn't understand them in the beginning. We're not quite sure if we understand them still, but we find them constantly. And that is the relationship between exposure to workplace bullying and health-related problems. Then you would think that those who are reactive, those who have problems with ordinary coping and so on, that they would be more vulnerable. And that people who are low on neuroticism, who have coping skills, hardiness, all these kinds of, we have a lot of labels in psychology for being a survivor, so to say.
Correct.
Of stress. But what we find constantly is that the relationship between exposure to bullying and health is only there for those who have strength in their personality. It is not there for those who are vulnerable.
That's counterintuitive.
It is.
Why?
So the first time we saw that was already in 2008. And what we looked at then was a group of all targets. They were all targets. There were 220 of them. But then, so they all claimed to be targets. And then we looked at the degree of exposure, because degree of exposure could still vary within. And then we looked at this sense of coherence, which is one kind of personality factor, since you have a hardiness, you master and you cope with stress and the stress of life, and you have a meaning of purpose and everything.
It's like an agency in the general sense.
Yeah.
Yes.
Go ahead. Yes, it is. And then it turned out that there was no relationship between level of exposure and PTSD symptoms when you had low levels of sense of coherence. But if you have high levels, then there were significant relationship. And if you look at it, you could, if we know where we are on television, we could have graphs so I could show you. But it shows that yes, all these sense of coherence, coping abilities, hardiness, resilience, whatever we call these personality traits that should make you fit for life. And
so yes, a positive cluster. Yes.
Yes. Whatever we look at, yes, when you're not bullied, yeah, those people are far much better off in terms of health. But when they are bullied, they have the same problems as those who are low on these kind of positive traits. And the relationship is only there for those who are, have these strengths. We've even done a study, I have a PhD student now, and there we looked at, we followed a group of teenagers. So we measured them when they were 13, when they were 14, and when they were 15. And we asked them each time, have you been bullied in the last term and the term before that? So we had six measurement points. And then we took those who were really bullied during, this is junior high school. Okay. And then we waited until they, and then we waited until they were 30. And then we looked at the relationship between what they were exposed to at the age of 30 and their kind of depression or more depressive mood, I would say. Okay. So they were a bit down. And then it turned out that there was no, for those who were bullied during junior high school, there were no relationship between exposure and depressed mood when they were 30. It was only there for those who weren't bullied during school, junior high school. This is mind-blowing, isn't it?
It's mind-blowing, but similarly, I and that's another strength of and a characteristic of the research that comes out of your group, your lab, the Bergen group, is the ability to do the longitudinal studies using the national health insurance numbers so you can track health outcomes. And what fascinated me was that one time where you did the five-year lag, three-way five-year on suicidal ideation. Mm-hmm. You remember that one where they were prior bullied, but they were no longer bullied, but they were still, was it twice as likely? They were much more likely. Describe that one. What was that? I remember that as
Yes, as you said, we had three measurable times over five years, and we measured a lot of different things. But then we looked at suicidal ideation. And as you said, because what we looked for there, there we can look at the causation in a sense, what comes first and what comes thereafter. And there, because even if depression may be a risk factor for something, suicidal ideation was not a risk factor for bullying. So it wasn't those who were contemplating that in the beginning who had problems later on. But if you were bullied at time one, then you had still multiple times, increased times of having suicidal ideation afterwards. So here we are quite sure that this comes after, because that was a discussion in the beginning of our research in the 90s and early 2000s. So, well, what is the chicken and egg riddle in this and so on. But when we came out 2005 and onwards, then we were able to do this. And now most of the studies we do are either longitudinal or they are shortitudinal.
And with shortitudinal.
Shortitudinal, I mean, then we measure people each day for 35 days. And then we look day by day what happens. So we can look at it on a daily level. That is interesting.
What do you see with that? Daily level.
For instance, we have one study with one of my new PhD students where we have a lot of studies on what we call a sailboat study. So what we have a big, fantastic sailor situated in Bergen, big one, three types of, okay. And this runs the oceans all over the world. But once a year, it takes naval officers or naval candidates to be officers on a trip from Norway, 35 days to New York. And then we measure them before they go on board, and they run the ship. That is what they do.
Part of their
trip. Then we measure them each day at 5 o'clock. We ask them about the last 24 hours. And then we can follow them day by day, and we can look what happens on a daily basis. And now is an interesting thing. These are the most hardy people of Norway. These are the naval officers. they are selected back in front. So these are the toughest.
There's no predisposed psychological vulnerability here.
No, they are picked away. But still, even on those days that they are exposed for a bullying-related behavior, then they are a bit down. And you could follow them. But we measured whether or not they felt bullied before they entered the ship. So are they taking with them a bullying situation on board? And then it turned out that, well, on the day that you experienced these kind of incivility acts, I would say, then people were down. So even the strongest of the strongest react even on a daily basis. But those who had the perception of being a victim, they also reacted day one and day two. So it says only, and this is what bullying is about. Repeated exposure over time is something different than a one-off. That's exactly what it is. So it should be that way. The interesting thing was, though, even those who had it only once reacted. So this is, and that was the strongest of the strongest in the kingdom.
Oh, that's fascinating. Daily observation, daily recording. Oh, my gosh. Yep. You know, okay, let me go there with this, too. With the various students, you seem to be pulled into, you're willing to go with their interests, clearly. It's their projects, and you then guide them and mentor them. But I think you've gone down some rabbit holes that are absolutely divergent from the mainstream. You just sent me this recent article about these beta receptors, and it involves a rat study and all of that. Mm-hmm. I'll let you summarize that one quickly, and then I want to do the 5-HTT one. Go ahead.
Yes. Well, and as I said, I am a clinical psychologist by training. And in Bergen, in Norway, in the whole, we are very strong on biological psychology. And I had a nature when I did my senior high school and college and so on. So I've always been interested in the kind of the biological explanation of what we see. There must be a biological explanation. And then some people with a more social constructivist approach, they would say, well, this is only words. It doesn't have any meaning in itself, okay? You can put whatever meaning you want into it. This is just socially constructed and so on. So I wanted to study rats where there are no language. And then I want to know, can we actually, what do you know? How do the brain react to the fact that you may even be hit by nothing? With this I mean, if you're exposed to bully or violence, okay, then your flesh would react, and that would send hormones to the brain, say, I'm hurt, okay? But when you're bullied, how does the brain react to that? And is it possible for us to see which kind of substrates in the brain that are evoked when you're bullied? And can they explain the health-related things? Is this just the brain making up stuff? So in order to do that, we did studies with rats. So we bullied them, put them in a bully-like situation without violence. There was no violence. And then we repeated this for seven days. And then we looked at the blood, the brain's substrates into the bones. And we, of course, had a control group of rats who experienced changes on a daily basis, but no bullying. And then we looked at what are the epigenetics, or what are the genetic factors that seems to be reacting to this. And then we took that knowledge, to make it short, and then looked at epigenetics among people humans. We used their spit, and then we used questionnaires and so on. And then we could look at this. So what we're looking at here is actually to find the causal link between what you perceive, but it doesn't hit you physically, but you perceive it. And one interesting finding, which I think was very interesting.
Excuse me, I'll stop you there. Is there a disconnection between then it can be, you can have the perception without the physiological?
Well, the rats have the physiological reaction and they have it instantly. And they have it so instantly because what we're actually studying here is rats growing up. So they're actually teenagers because they are still supposed to grow, okay? So what we do—
And the brain is still developing.
It's still developing and the body's still developing, but those who are exposed to bullying, they stop growing. So they don't grow anymore. So those who are just experiencing changes, they grow on a normal curve. But if you then compare the growth curve of those who are not bullied with those who are bullied, then you will see that those who are bullied, they stop, the growth process stops. So now you know that their body is reacting.
Very much so. Arrested development. Oh my gosh. Yeah. When you did the—
I wanted to go past this kind of discussion. Is this psychology or are they imagining things or whatever? I really wanted to see what actually goes on in the body. And we did another study where we had physiotherapists who actually did a clinical examination of patients in the clinic that we had for many years. So because we wanted to know, there are research from the US saying that the brain register physical pain and social pain in the exact same area. Okay, so social pain can will be perceived as the same as physical pain, but then you don't know, is it just the bad brain or is this actually in the bodies? That you don't know.
No.
So we actually had physiotherapists examining them, their bodies. And then we showed, no, it's in the bodies. It's in the muscles. It is in the skin. It is in everything. This gets under your skin, into your body. And we know a bit about the more biological processes in the brain that transfer these experiences into bodily phenomena.
I just loved, it always ends at the amygdala, not ends, but that amygdala is such a central part of the brain. The fact that I've always been struck by that TTS syndrome where when the person's distressed chronically, not only do we get the atrophy of the amygdala, but then it sends a signal and it's what leads to the enlarged left ventricle of the heart. My gosh, what a remarkable connection. But you chased me down a rabbit hole. I didn't ever know about the SLC6A4 gene on the 17th chromosome till I read a paper by you and your students about the serotonin reuptake transporter. And it set me backwards, working backwards. What in the world are we talking about? Well, there's this one gene responsible for these two phenotypes of short and long alleles that are going to play out in the structure and function of the amygdala. And then you take it from there. You did this study. It didn't produce the outcomes, desired outcomes. But I'm going to tell you why I think that happened. But you go ahead and discuss.
No, please. I'm interested.
So no, I think you just have the... You had bullied and non-bullied people, and you had the genomic analysis of the allele lengths and all that. But it was also you had taken, after all that technicality, you had to use that 0 to 10 pain perception scale. I thought that was, had you had the stronger kinds of pain perception things, but please. Do the teaching about what exactly that was about, because serotonin is such an important neurotransmitter and how it plays such a role. And how did you get involved? Was that?
Well, that was kind of some of the data that we— this was a study where we planned the study by the rats and so on, and then we discovered, well, we have some data that we can use among humans. So that's also why we had to use the scales that we had to use for that. But like I said, for all these studies, I think that's an important thing to say. Yes, there are genes that may say something about how you react, pain, depression, anxiety, and so on. And yes, there are genes that will tell us how strongly you react, but everyone reacts.
That's important. That's the lesson.
That's the main part of it, I would say. Also, until we get so far, when my students find out that that's actually something we can do to repair those things, or that we can stop these mechanisms. So
now I'm going to go back farther in time. Mm-hmm. The other work that you're involved with that I admire so much because it broadened it broadens the concept of leadership, study of leadership, beyond the positive focus that we have here in the States. We're always talking about constructive leadership, positive leadership, a good balance between the focus on the worker and the organization. But in the two-dimensional, four-quadrant space that you describe and name four styles of destructive leadership, I think that's made the model so much more realistic. And by that token, you want to just talk about that? Because I remember, I think it was in the Wales conference where you said, but people, there are two anchors, two dimensions. there are more quadrants here. There are more cells in this table. Would you describe that briefly?
Well, I think that leadership research went wrong in the 50s, 60s. After searching for all the personality traits that distinguishes good leaders from non-leaders and so on, and then they found more or less nothing, then they started to ask the question, but what do they do? And then they said, but what do good leaders do? But they should have asked the questions, what do leaders do? So that it went wrong from there. And from there on, we got models saying that, well, you differ on different dimensions, task, structure, organization, humans, motivation, and so on. But they all went from zero, or one actually, from 1 to 9 or 1 to 10. And I always thought, well, couldn't you be worse than doing worse things than nothing? It's worse, the worst thing you could do. We also did a study in developing this where we investigated if nothing is nothing. It's actually nothing.
What is the absence of?
Yeah, well, what is the summative absence of? And there, of course, you have laissez faire leadership.
As you're doing
that. Which is the summative nothing. So, because each and every day, leaders have to ask the questions, do I do something in this situation or do I wait? Do I intervene? Do I not? And you can't every day do everything. So we have to say, well, I will wait with this. But if you do this a lot, then you have a laissez faire. And is that nothing? Because before we came in, it was seen as ineffective, actually meaning having zero effect. So we started to look, and then we found, no, it has an effect. It has a minus effect. And then
it
we went on.
It takes the dark side.
Yeah. And we have struggled there. We struggled there with the American Journal, having them seeing as laissez-faire is actually a destructive leadership. It isn't ineffective. It is effective in a negative sense, because in their minds, it is zero leadership. But the absence of something, the avoidance of something, is not zero. And even if you avoid doing things that you are expected to do, so that's the one thing of it, laissez-faire leadership. And now we know more and more about laissez-faire, which is a... What we find now is that if you combine risk factors for bullying in the work environment and you combine that with laissez-faire, then it predicts later exposure. But if you have these risk factors and there's no laissez-faire leadership, then the risk factor doesn't work anymore. So they are gone. So role stress, for instance, is just being involved in interpersonal conflicts at one point in time. 2 years later, your risk of being bullied is only there if you have a laissez-faire leader. So that's one thing. The other thing we did was that just to draw the lines from 9 to 0 to -9. So we did that for tasks and structure and organizational focus. And then we did the same thing for employee-centered leadership. So going beyond I've had people say to me that had my boss only, if my boss only did nothing, I would be quite happy. The problem is that she starts to do something. That's what it's about. So then we have a four quadrant with laissez-faire in the middle, which is a destructive thing. And then you have people who are, or leaders who are high on organizational focus, high on structure, high on task-oriented leadership, but they are minus on employee-centered. There you have the tyrants. So then you have the negative, which, so you are destructive both towards the organization and towards your employees. And there we struggled a bit of finding what kind of label would you put on that.
Yes.
And then we discovered a label that we found in the US, hidden away somewhere, that was called derailed. So you got off tracks. You're two tracks. You are supposed to be there, take care of the organization, take care of your employees, and combine that in a positive way. So now you're destructive both towards the organization and towards your employees. So you go off track, you are derailed. Then we came to the one who we didn't find anything in the literature. And that is when you're positive towards your subordinates. So you're supportive, you're nice, you're friendly, you're all those sort of things. But your destructive thoughts to your organization. Corruption would be one way of doing in that. Running for your personal goals instead of the organizational goals would be kind of misuse of resources and so on. There we struggled a bit before we found the label, and we ended up with supportive but disloyal. Now, the good thing of thinking that way is that suddenly then the organization and the employees would have the same interest in preventing and stopping destructive leadership, because it also hits the organization. And then you have this kind of the old term, the paradox of tyrannical leadership.
Yes.
And the paradox is there. You may start as a person who are focused on the job, but your negative thoughts towards people. So you're working not through, but over your employees. But the paradox is that these people tend to become derailed quite quickly.
I love the completeness of the model. I use it. I do expert. So much of my time now is expert witness in legal cases. It's starting to consume my life. Even though we don't have a legal standard in the US. Anyway, long story short, I use derailed quite a bit to describe some of the defendants in these cases, yep. These abusive yep. people. But I also, in my course, I have an illustration for you, the disloyal supportive, because you're right. It's a strange one combination. But there was this fellow in a major US corporation, I best not name, that I was called in for his case. It was a criminal case. It was not civil penalty. It was criminal. Because what he had done when his reaction to getting a new bully manager after he had already had a 20-year successful career was so unsettling to him. He didn't know how to strike back. And the way he struck back was he bought things. The corporation had an unlimited expense account. He bought a Jaguar and put it in a garage to get back. He's going to get back at the company, but he loves his staff. So he showers them with gifts, expensive gifts. And he ran up millions of dollars of charges, which sent him to prison. And he loved his people, but he hated the company. And I thought, well, now there's the illustration. But the poor man paid a price.
A wonderful happening when we made the model originally. We were sitting in my office, myself and my colleague Professor Skogstad, and we had two students with us, two master students, very brilliant young women. And we were sitting there, and we had just drawn up the lines on a piece of paper. This is called theoretical development. You draw a line, pass 0 to minus 10. And then we got these four quadrants. And then we thought, well, what would we call them? Okay, tyrannical was easy enough. Okay, derailed. But then the one we really struggled with was that negative, destructive towards the organization, positive towards employees. And then one of these girls said, well, those leaders doesn't exist, she said. They just don't exist. And then we said, oh, stop. Let's try to develop how they could have been if they existed. Let's play with how would they be like. And then we started to playing around more with kind of build, making up examples of how they took resources from the organizations, but they provided the subordinates with nice things and so on. And they kind of, and then she became quieter and quieter as we went along, speculating of how they could have been. And in, so, and we were very enthusiastic and engaged, but suddenly we realized she wasn't saying anything and she was quite pale in her face. And then I asked, sorry, are you ill or are you feeling bad? And then she said, it's my boss you're talking about. Is that, and that illustrates, it illustrates something else. And that is, if as long as you don't have concepts and mental models to think in, you may not see it.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And of course, as an employee, she hadn't seen it that way before.
I want to talk about your relationships with the people who've studied with you and the rest, but I think that the relationship that probably goes back the longest is with Helgi Holt, but yes. You were not student. Tell us about Helgi, because yeah. I also admire his work so much.
Yeah, Helgi, that's interesting. I live in Bergen, Norway, on the west coast, the second largest city, but I come from an island about 2.5 hours away as a young man. Helgi is originally from Bergen, but he went, he became a teacher, and then he started to work in labor unions, and then he became a trainer in a hotel chain and so on. And then he fell in love in the UK 30 years ago, and then he moved over there. Then in the late 90s, 96, 97, he contacted me because he wanted to do a PhD and he wanted to do research on workplace bullying. I got a letter, not an email. I got a letter. It was before emails. And then but as a Norwegian, he has of course read our books and he knew what we were doing. So he got in contact and we started to work together. And I started to travel to England because our research was further ahead than English at that time. So I came over, did talks at his university and for different kinds of organizations and so on. But then later on, about 2003-04, we had a large national campaign in Norway against workplace bullying. It was initiated by the Prime Minister, went down to the Department of Labor and then into the Labor Inspectorate. And then they combined that with the labor unions and the employers unions. So it was a three-party project that went on for 3 years. And at that time, we had discovered that England actually had gone very fast ahead in practical terms. So we took Helge from the UK with his experience there. And also, because the English were a bit better than us in the formal aspects. They had investigation procedures for racism going on, for instance. They had it for the lack of, well...
had they begun racism, those employment procedure. Tribunals also in the UK?
They had all this kind of system, which they didn't think about bullying before we came and kind of they discussed it. And then there were more colleagues in England. But then they thought, well, we have the system. The system of handling it, but we haven't thought about bullying before. So in one sense, they were earlier than us. So then I brought Helge to Norway to talk about those things, and we had a three-year-long project financed by the Norwegian state where we developed interventions and so on. And then we started to do research together, and now we just published the third edition of the big book on workplace bullying. So.
Interesting that tripartite approach is the same as the ILO, the International Labor yes. Organization, and their yes. approach, which yeah. takes me to the fact that some of these very current studies, you and your students are basically lobbying for and trying to prove the efficacy of something called a conflict management climate that is going to be basically jointly, collaboratively created between company management and employees. But why don't you describe what a what this CMC, conflict management climate is.
I had this idea all from the beginning that there must be something in how an organization handles and doesn't handle conflict in general that must be very important in order to prevent or as a risk factor for workplace bullying. But
then, wait, I got to stop you there. Oh, let's stop. One of the key things that I've always cited you on for years and years and years is because we're behind you by 7 years in history anyway. So I've always deferred to you, and it's in your definition. Bullying is not conflict. It is not conflict between two equally powered parties. Mm-hmm. Say a phrase or a word about that to the group, and then go ahead and do this other.
Yeah, because what Walter thought and found that was interpersonal conflict was a risk factor for later development, but it isn't the same. And we just 2018, we actually also published a paper that looked at, well, when things are very, very low escalators or very, very early stages, it could be difficult to see which is which. But when it escalates, it becomes more and more different. And when it's really highly escalated, then this kind of the strength of the problems in workplace does not resemble what happens in conflicts whatsoever. But it is a risk factor. It may start there, and then it develops, and it turns into something which is no longer two equal parties, which is no longer an equal battle, and which is with quite different behaviors.
Here in the States, the businesses still want to mediate bullying. They think it needs to be mediated because they mistake it as conflict. But yours is a broad. When you talk about this now, I'll let you get back to the conflict management climate, which is a much bigger thing that could maybe preclude bullying.
Yes, because now we are in a preventive area. But still, the organization needs to have its policy in place. It needs to have its procedures in place. It needs to have fair procedures in place. They need to have a good collaboration with the labor unions, with the employee representatives. Okay. The staff needs to know these procedures, and they need to know where do I go if I have a situation which is becoming more and more problematic, and what will happen if I raise a case. That is basically the climate of conflict management. So it is the perception that I am conflict-wise in a safe organization, organization which is prepared to handle these cases, where it's safe to raise them, where the manager has its competencies, but also its methods, its complaints procedures, and so on.
And that the organization won't invest all of its energy to deny the presence of trouble and go on and attack and denigrate the complainant and all the rest. That's where we continue to get it stuck here. Is it assumed in Norway that there'll be management employee or union representation or employee representation on committees and in decision making on these types of matters?
Oh yes, if you are to build, let's say you would like to build a policy around it, that would be developed and jointly by the labor union, by the management, and by the health and safety representative, which is also an elected position. So we have two kinds of employee representatives: the labor union, which may cover many, but not all of the employees, but many. But then you have the health and safety representative, which is also elected, and his or her task is to look after that the work environment procedures and systems are working according to the law, and to see that in specific cases that all the rules and regulations are followed. Also the internal systems that the organization would develop, but they would not develop those without any collaboration with the labor unions. That would never happen. It would work if you did.
Why not?
Well, first of all, by law, you have to. By agreement, you have to, and by tradition, you do.
Good Lord, what a difference in societal approaches.
Yeah. There's no way you can have this as success with that if you don't do that. There's no way.
How's the CMC model related to the composition of an ethical infrastructure that you and your sister write about?
Yeah, well, that is the overarching concept that we are using, the ethical infrastructures. But that consists of the formal systems, the policies, the sanction systems, the surveillance systems. Well, do you include it in your well, we have yearly surveys of the work environment. So do you put it in there? Do you have formal training? Do you have for managers, for labor unions, and for employees? So that's the formal thing. So what you got there? And then you have the informal thing, which is, in one sense, the same thing on an informal basis. Do employees kind of sanction each other? Do they survey each other, and so on? And then conflict management climate is a part of that. That is, what is the subjective perception of how the formal system works in practice? So,
and they all fit hand in glove with the psychosocial safety climate of.
You could say that as a climate for conflict management, you could look at that as a sub-concept of the psychosocial safety climate, because the psychosocial safety climate is a much, much broader concept. It says something about, is this an organization who cares for the health and well-being of workers? But this is a much more specific one. Are you laissez-faire when it comes to handling workplace bullying, disagreements, conflicts? Or are you an organization with your system in place, with it functioning in practice, with managers who have the tasks, who have the methods and the attitude of doing it, and do the employees have the knowledge of how to raise an issue and the certainty that it will be handled in a fair sense?
Yes, yes. Can you do it without risk of emotional injury, psychological injuries? Yeah,
but what is really a bit surprising is how strong that factor is, because we have studied, the first study we did show that, and then we looked at exposure to workplace bullying, how that is related to lowered motivation, lowered job engagement. You don't have to be a psychologist or a professor of work or sensational psychology to have the hypothesis exposure to bullying lowers your motivation. No big deal. And of course it did, but it only did for those working in a low climate for conflict management. For those who scored high, there was no relationship between exposure to bullying and job engagement. So it isn't the bullying, it's the organization. And then we did another study where we looked at risk factors. So we looked at risk factors, role conflict, high demands, those kind of typical psychosocial risk factors for workplace bullying. And then we looked at the climate for conflict management on a team level. So it was the team, not the one who was exposed. And that showed that, first of all, in teams where there were high conflict management climate, there were much, much lower prevalence of workplace bullying. So it prevents workplace bullying. But it also took away the effect of the risk factors. So the risk factors went to zero.
Insulates them. It actually protects, yes.
Yeah, it just, so they are only risk factors as long as they happen in a climate where it is less fair in terms of conflict management. Doesn't happen. And now we have a last study, and what was not, but also a study that where we just follow people over time. So we measured it one time, and then we measured it again 6 months later. And all the theories and our experiences, workplace bullying tends to escalate over time. Okay. So then we look, does it escalate over time? Only if you worked in a climate that scored low on climate for conflict management. If you scored high, it never escalated in terms. So it only happens in those environments.
Low CMC climates, low CM organizations. I did a podcast with our mutual friend, Maureen Duffy. Mm-hmm. And she, of course, is a clinician, but... What was her whole argument is, let's get off the individual. It's the organizations. Come on. Please.
I like to put it this way. I like to put it this way. Going back to one of your earlier presidents doing his campaign, a successful campaign, and then he said, "It's the economy, stupid." And now we can translate it: "It's the organization, stupid."
Yes. Yes. Very much so. The.
But I would like to say that still that. But we want to check everything. When we come to say this organization, we have checked personality, we have checked biology, we have checked everything. So when we make the case for this, we have checked the other things. So we spent a lot of time researching things that turned out not to be so important.
It's good to eliminate.
It is.
It's good to eliminate.
It is, because if you don't, then your story is much, much weaker.
What's like your model, destructive leadership? What have you not been looking at? Mm-hmm. Ask, one of the questions I've always had is, and I've never been able to ask it. Maybe I should ask it in our national studies. Oh, I should ask this first. What's your national prevalence, do you think? I saw some of the older ones. You were hovering around 6.8%, 7%, 8%, but you're always under 10%. Yes.
Yes. But I think bullying tends to come in two phases or two levels. It's a more what some would call an incivility level and so on. And then you have the really hard victimization cases. If you look at all these all together, the whole spectrum, if you really take into account everything, you may talk about 10%. But if you look to the cases that would fall under the more stricter the definition, you are down to 2-4%.
Good Lord. You're still a third of our national prevalence. I run these national studies. But I have the self-report item. I did put it's labeled as abusive conduct. So I'm trying to get at the more severe thing. But I guess I'd be remiss. No, I want to answer the question that I've always wanted to pose. How much could we eliminate? How much of bullying is attributable to lack of managerial skill? They don't know so much. And I see bullying as a mask, as a cover, as if targets are reactionary, which we know they are, and so are offending, abusive managers and coworkers who are trying to cover their own shortcomings.
Yeah.
What do you think?
But if you go even a step higher up, it's again, but what are the organizations that these people are working in?
Well, that's
how is the ethical in infrastructure? Are they allowed to do so? Are they receiving reward for doing so? Are they ever stopped? And how is upper management doing this when it comes to hiring, when it comes to training, when it comes to stopping behavior and reacting to actual cases? I think more and more that sometimes I've heard the sentence in a kind of employee-centered leadership thinking, you get, as an employee, you get the leaders you deserve.
Oh.
You hear that sentence?
Oh.
Terrible sentence. No.
Oh, yes, it is.
You get the leaders you get, but the organization gets the leader it deserves.
I agree. And in terms of national, and let's take it to, we move the unit of analysis from the individual, the team, to the organization. What about public policy? I remember the first ordinance ever in the world was in Sweden, right? Following Lehman's work and all. And I think you and Helge went in and did the evaluation, the 10-year follow-up, but there wasn't much to show. What has been anything recently done with respect to national public policy efficacy anywhere?
It was interesting that time because Sweden was very early on, even as early as us and even a bit earlier. But then they got into a financial economical recession in the late 90s. So it kind of went away. And then in 2004-5, there was a suggestion in the parliament that they would actually just abandon the whole thing. And then we went in and interviewed the key stakeholders and evaluated it. And what was interesting, and the question was, why didn't it work? It was supposed to be the best in the world. It doesn't seem to work. What was the problem? And there were many problems, but one of the biggest problems was that, well, the legal framework was lying there, and it was perfect and good. But people were working, so that lay on one table, but people were working on another table. And no one had told them what that meant on a day-to-day basis in the organization. So there were no translation between the legal framework and the ethical infrastructure.
The daily operational. Yeah.
Yes. So that's the problem. That's the problem. And that's what we've been doing over the last, I would say, 15 years, is to look at. I've been written books in Norwegian then about law and law and leadership and law and work environment and so on. Because I think we have very good laws, but you need to translate them. And the lawyers, the legal people do not translate them into work operations. So what do we do based on these things? So that is the big problem. Someone needs to translate it into working organizational psychology. So what do we do, when, who do it, how do we do it? That was the main thing. So that's been one of our, in more practical terms, the things we've been working on. But there are, so it's interesting that Sweden was away for many years. They just went away. And then they came back again as a country in 2015 with a new legal system. And then the interest in Sweden just exploded. So I just came back last week from a week of training in Sweden. So now I train even more people in Sweden than I train in Norway. For that reason, they came very strong. And when the Swedes do something, they do it properly. They are very well organized and structured and nice people. So when they do something, they really do it.
What about the Norwegian initiative? When you brought Helge over and you had the 3 years, mm-hmm. and there was a tremendous mm-hmm. focus, what's the follow up to that? What were the outcomes?
Well, the outcomes were, first of all, a lot of attention, a lot of awareness. So that was kind of perhaps the main thing. But we also developed investigation methods to investigate cases, because we didn't have that actually in Norway. So we took some experiences from England, and then we developed a Norwegian tool for that. And we've been training a lot of investigations, hundreds, thousands of them in the days after. So I think one of the best things that came out of it was actually a long-held basic awareness in our culture. So the awareness in our culture of this is very, very strong. It's so strong that even being accused of bullying is now perhaps even as a health risk as being exposed, because the culture is extremely kind of against it.
That's your informal surveillance operating. Mm,
definitely.
Actually, when it becomes that normative, well, then there's a self-policing. Within the organization.
But that led us to a new problem when this started to happen about 15, 16, 17, 18 years ago. Then it started, and then it was driven even higher by this state initiative and the national initiative. But then we needed also fair investigation procedures, because when you come to that point, then claiming to be a victim of bullying also becomes a weapon in conflicts. So it turns a bit. So that means that you need actually to go in a fair way to investigate the cases.
Because, well, you have to ferret out the false positives, the ones who want to appropriate the process just because they were evaluated poorly, because they are poor workers and they hate their job.
Oh, yeah.
But then they want to claim to be a victim. Yeah, that's problematic. I'm with you 100% on the investigatory component. It needs to be done, usually not by a single individual, not by human resources, and we've got so much to do here in this country. I'll end with the fact that we have yet to enact a backup. We created the health David Yamada, our legal eagle, mm-hmm. created and wrote what I dubbed the Healthy Workplace Bill, piece of legislation, but we have to go state by state, each of the 50, because of a variety of complications with federal law. And we got involved. First, it was introduced in California in 2003. And then I trained a bunch of volunteers. We had it introduced in as many as 31 states, sometimes 10, 15 at a time. And then all the craziness of the political world happened. And they're too busy denying women's rights and denying the right to vote. So there's not much going on. Right now in Yamada's home state of Massachusetts, we are moving forward again, but it is so hard to get this type of legislation in America. I just have to tell you, I remember how he confronted me at one of the conferences and said, "Why haven't you passed the law?" I said, "Because it's America." No. Go ahead.
But then you have the new initiative from the ILO, National Labor Organization, yes. and the yes. Convention 190. And at the moment, we are working in Norway to kind of revise our Work Environment Act to be in line with that. It doesn't take much. The only problem we have in Norway with it, because it aligns totally with what we have already. But there's a small problem there from a Norwegian's point of view. And that is, they try to capture the new working life where the employment relations are more diverse than they used to be. Okay, right. You have Uber, for instance, you have Uber and all those kinds of where you're not actually employed. Actually, you are self-employed, but you work and so on. So they try to, so that's a good initiative, try to cover more of those who are working. The problem is that we don't want those arrangements in Norway. So we can't just take the convention and say it's Norwegian law, because then we would actually open up for employment relations that we don't want.
Good point. Is there equivalence? I know the ILO is very much like the Canadian, it's a guidance document, yes. Mm-hmm. I was just exposed to this ISO 45003, and it's all about psychosocial risks, which multinational corporations have to comply with. At least it's more than a guidance, it's a compliance document. Is that seen that?
Yes, I have seen it.
Could that be used, do you think?
It could be used. It doesn't bring much more than we all already have in Norway, so it doesn't provide us with more. But in and of itself, I thought, well, this is a step forward in many countries, definitely. But we are all already there, been there for a long time. So,
well, for us, it would be. Mm-hmm. All right. We could go on forever, but I don't want to impose any more on your time. I want to thank you for speaking with me and for our audience. Again, I honor you as the research pioneer. It's you do marvelous work. So let me
thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
Thanks for listening. We'll be back soon with another episode. Until then, please visit us at workplacebullying.org. You'll find some great resources there for current and past targets, years of research, including our WBI national surveys and our books. Also at the site, you can learn about my expert witness services, Workplace Bullying University training for professionals, and the Respectful Conduct Clinic to deal with identified offenders. And new in 2021 is a community dedicated to workplace bullying that you can join called Safe Harbor. Thanks again for listening. Remember, work shouldn't hurt.